Hello, this is my review of the game Mechwarrior Online. If you're watching this video, then you probably know what Mechwarrior Online is, or at least enough about it to wonder if it's worth playing. If you don't know what Mechwarrior Online is, well, you can look that up for yourself. But here's a few seconds of what it's all about. It's a free-to-play, mech sim-ish shooter about giant robots that must fight for space feudalism against warrior space communists, and also each other. It's a lot like the Middle Ages, where they believed that space was flat. It's all based in the BattleTech universe, which makes it both pretty cool and phenomenally stupid. But we love it anyway. Now I'll cut to the point, summarize my thoughts on the game, and then I'll explain why in more detail. So, is it worth playing? Sure, I guess, if you're a bit of a masochist. Actually, no. I'm gonna give it a no. Now someone out there is asking, but why would you say that's a bad game when you have over 460 hours in it? So why would you say it's a bad game when you're playing it right now? Now I'm not saying that it's a bad game, just that I would not recommend it. The gameplay is fun, and there's enough depth there to keep you coming back, but it has problems. Big problems. I'm going to talk about my problems with the game before I get into why it's still fun. Okay, the first thing that I want to get out of the way is that this game has the worst free-to-play grind that I have ever seen. I have played other free-to-play games, such as World of Tanks, War Thunder, and a few others, but all of them fall short of how bad the grinding in this game can be. Most free-to-play games will offer new players a much faster grind at the beginning of the game that slowly ramps up in intensity as you climb up the ranks, ensuring that you get invested in the game so that you're willing to spend money to keep going. Mechwarrior Online almost does the opposite. Shortly after the start, you get the full grinding experience, and then that grind gets only a little bit better over time as you acquire spare equipment from older purchases and gain a roster of different mechs to rotate out to smooth out the grinding process. At the beginning, you get a cadet bonus, which over the course of your first 25 matches will give you a significant payout boost. While this is a nice boost for new players, it can just as easily lure someone into a false sense of security. Once the credit boost ends, you will find yourself earning what suddenly feels like next to nothing. The cadet bonus that you start with is enough to buy your first mech of choice and customize it to your liking, but it won't get you much further than that. The first mech that you buy will be the easiest to grind for. The second mech that you buy will be the hardest. For a casual player, that sudden vertical cliff where you're suddenly earning so little income can put you off from playing the game forever, especially because it comes as a shock if you weren't paying attention to the difference between the cadet bonus and the regular earnings. Sure, you can find a game with a worse grind in the long run, but this game takes the cake for putting new players into the thick of it so early on. This is my number one problem with the game. If the massive grind after the sudden income cliff weren't enough, you can only get a grand total of 4 mechs before you're forced to spend real cash money on the game to get more of them. You have to buy mech bays so that you have available slots to put your new mechs, or else you cannot obtain them. Putting a paywall up against new players who have yet to pass the first tier sends the wrong message. The game's monetization is based around cash whales who will spend large amounts of money on their nostalgic love of the BattleTech universe. And if you aren't one of those, then this game is going to make you feel very unwelcome. Now some people watching this are going to say that I'm wrong, and that you can grind for mech bays. If you had said that prior to the recent revamp of faction warfare, which made it actually playable, I might have asked you to die in a fire. I was crazy enough to do it, so I know. However, since then, this has become a viable, but still very painful way to grind for a limited number of mech bays. Eventually, you're going to have to spend some cash, or you aren't going to be allowed to progress any further. Grinding for mech bays involves joining one of the game's factions, then slowly grinding out the loyalty points for that faction in the game's most competitive mode. Once you earn a mech bay from that faction, you can swap to a different faction for a 7-day cooldown timer, which cuts your already small currency earnings in that mode by 20% for the duration. It involves gaming the system rather than being a feature of the game, and it's a painful way to do it. Now, back to the topic at hand. So just how bad is the grind exactly? Well, let me give you an example. Let's say that we want a mid-tier mech that will help us grind out the in-game currency, called C-bills. We want something competitive, versatile, and reasonable. Let's start with the Catapult C1 variant. To buy the mech itself without any additions, it'll cost us 5,800,427 C-bills. Now, something worth noting is that when you buy a new mech, their stock loadouts are absolute garbage 90% of the time. This catapult's default loadout is one of the better starting loadouts, but we're still going to want to make it more effective, or else it's going to be eaten alive by other players. I'm not going to min-max it either, we just want it to be a good mech. First of all, there are 4 chassis upgrades available: ferrofibrous armor, double heat sinks, endosteel structure, and Artemis guidance systems. The heatsink upgrade is mandatory for all mechs. The endosteel upgrade is mandatory for 90% of all mechs. Ferrofibrous is situational, and Artemis is a situational trade-off for missile mechs. Get the 2 mandatory upgrades. With those upgrades, our mech now costs 7,954,127 C-bills. That's more than an additional 2 million in hidden costs, but we're not done yet. 2 tons of ammo is abysmal, and you'll run out fast. Triple that. We still have 4 tons available, so let's add 3 heat sinks in the side torsos. Now maximize the front armor on all torso sections, and put the rest on the arms. Our mech has now jumped in cost from under 6 million C-bills to over 8 million C-bills. This was essentially just to make it playable. If we wanted to optimize it by adding Artemis guidance and an extra large engine, we would be adding more than 5 million to that cost, which more than doubles what we paid for the mech. Now let's assume that each match lasts 10 minutes from start to finish. Let's also assume that your earnings average at 150,000 C-bills per match. It'll take us 55 matches to earn the money that we need for the new mech. That's almost 10 hours of grinding to get your second mech, which isn't even optimized. Doing that would add another 6 hours to our grind. Even worse is that this is a solidly middling mech. If we wanted to kit out an assault class mech, we could end up going over 20 million C-bills. And the cheapest mechs almost always have large hidden costs. This segues into my second major complaint about this game. One of the greatest things about the game is the mech customization, but the amount of time that you have to spend grinding to customize mechs prohibits you from doing just that. You don't have any way to test out builds for a mech until you've invested possibly many hours or weekends into it. You could save up for a new mech only to realize that you hate it, or that it just doesn't work very well. Every time that you want to try something different, it's going to cost you even more C-bills. Because of that, you have to be very deliberate in what you save up for. You don't get the fun of testing all kinds of weird builds because everything that you want to try requires investing. As you play the game, you'll slowly start to acquire unused equipment that can be swapped around onto different mechs. But getting to the point where new builds aren't a large time investment is a long uphill battle. For me, there's always some new build that I want to try, but I never get to do because it requires investing in a new 5 million C-bill engine. Let's say, though, that you do want to spend some money to get by some of that grind. A basic MC package, which is the game's premium currency, costs $7 and gets you 1,250 MC. A catapult, bear in mind, a catapult with no work done to it, will cost around 2,400 MC. The MC cost for the C-bills you'll be fixing this mech with will cost you 800 MC per 1,100,000 C-bills. Earnings for everything scale with how much you spend, so you can bring that cost down a bit by simply buying more. Now I'm sure that some of the whales are singing that you shouldn't be buying the mechs directly. You should be buying the mech packs so that you can get multiple variants of the same mech for a large discount. This is true, but the fact remains that those in-game costs are there. Buying with cash also does nothing to affect the hidden costs after getting a new mech, which requires more cash to fix and optimize loadouts. The mech pack costs from the web store are about $20 for any mech, which includes 3 variants of it and cosmetic add-ons. The costs increase for those who want to include special content such as hero variant mechs. Now, on the brighter side, the game has very good prices for cosmetic purchases. The average cost for a mech color is 500 MC, which is only a few dollars. Once purchased, they can be applied to any mech and are unlocked permanently. Decals are even cheaper, while also being permanent. Mech skins are the most expensive, as they only apply to the specific mech purchased for. One-shot skins can be purchased very cheaply, but can only be applied once to a single mech each time. You don't earn cosmetics through gameplay, but it's still the fairest part of the purchasing system. My third and final major complaint is about the game's state in general. There's a lot of problems, both big and small. When I look back at it all, I start to get the feeling that it's all held together by duct tape. The game functionally feels like an early beta test. Sweeping changes to the game's functionality and mass nerfing make the game unstable. Attempts to fix the game's imbalances often implement heavy-handed, wide-sweeping measures that unintentionally nerf things that weren't a part of the problem.
I'm ready.
No, you ain't!
Possibly the most bizarre change made to the game was done over the last summer, when a large number of the game's mechs were rescaled. Rather than a fix to make certain mechs more viable or accurate, it ended up being a huge game changer that broke half of the light mech roster by making them larger than some heavyweight mechs. More than half of a year later, only a handful of light mechs are ever used regularly, and this bizarre problem remains an issue. The game has poor quality control, and new features often seem rushed for lack of bug testing. A recent change to the appearance of the minimap made sector grids very difficult to tell apart. A different bug caused an alarm sound to play throughout an entire match on the map Terra Therma for multiple players, every match. Decals from player mechs were projecting themselves onto nearby terrain. Certain mechs were not fully rendering at long distances. These are all bugs that have been introduced in the last few months, but have all since been fixed soon after they're released. Not all problems are fixed so quickly, however. For months now, the map Alpine Peaks, when paired with the game mode Domination, has resulted in a landslide victory for one specific side 100% of the time, due to the other side being forced to fight on open terrain against enemies with cover. There has been no mention of fixing this issue. As one-offs, they aren't a big deal, but buggy releases are more normal than not. The game's feature development in general seems to be grossly understaffed or undervalued. The year 2016 saw little development of the game at all, with months in between the release of any noteworthy content. In total, only two new maps were made, while two maps were replaced, and some of the other existing maps received graphical updates. A 4v4 scouting game mode was introduced in the summer to Faction Warfare, but largely went unplayed due to Faction Warfare being unfinished and having no player base. When I say it had no player base, I mean that it had no player base. It was normal to look for a match and find exactly zero other players available. Finding a match could take hours. To this day, parts of the game seem feature incomplete. The clan factions have 12 varieties of autocannons, while the Inner Sphere factions have only 6. 3 sizes of Ultra Autocannons and Shotgun Autocannon are conspicuously absent from the Inner Sphere roster. The same goes for lock-on short-range missiles, in which sizes that should exist simply do not. For the entirety of a year's worth of development, all that mattered were less than a handful of maps. There are a lot of areas and many maps that have bad hit detection. I often find myself shooting into invisible walls. This problem gets 10 times worse when firing over long ranges. No matter what your graphics settings are, the terrain detail is dropped at a distance, while the hit detection is not. It's far too easy to miss shots repeatedly due to mechs appearing to be exposed only to be hidden by invisible terrain. The one area where content development shines is new mech releases. At least one new mech is released every month, and each one offers new playstyle options. Each new mech is a beautiful redesign of classic BattleTech mechs, with custom cockpit models, animations, and skins. Currently, the game has over 70 different mechs, spread across 4 weight classes, each of them having four or more different variants, which all come with different weapon hardpoints and bonuses. While development of this game has historically been poor, recent months have shown a dramatic increase in both planned and released content. Since the beginning of this year, Faction Warfare has been revamped with variations of quick play game modes and fixed some long-standing issues. Finding players is no longer impossible. An entirely new game mode was released as well, with a revamped assault game mode planned in the near future. What excites me personally is the announcement that new weapons will finally be added to the game, as the current lineup is only a fragment of what's available in the Battletech universe. Not to mention the state of the current lineup missing many autocannon and missile types. The game now holds events every few weeks, and sales every so often. Prizes for completing various challenges can include everything from small experience or C-build boosts to earning in-game premium cash, which can be exchanged for mech bays, skins, or anything else. On occasion, even hero mechs have been made available as prizes. This helps a great deal with the game's grinding difficulties, and the free premium boosts that usually accompany them make the grind feel closer to what it should be. Unlike many other games, there are no tiers of mech. There are weight classes, of course, but every mech is meant to be playable at every level. Mechs do not become outdated as you progress. This is part of what makes the grind so bad, but it's also a great strength of the game. There's a lot more variety on the battlefield, and the first mech that you fall in love with won't have to be replaced later on. You can keep coming back to it. The game has a modest roster of free trial mechs for players to find their preferred playstyle and get ideas for new mechs. It also helps a lot with getting through the grind, so as not to be stuck with only a couple of mechs for a long time. These mechs cannot be modified in any way, but they all have good loadouts for their chassis. This can be a godsend for new players who have no mechs to play, and is even useful later on for players who are unsure of what mechs to work toward buying next. The core of the game's balance issues are caused by problems in Battletech itself, which thrives off of power creep. To PGI's credit, they've done an excellent job of bringing balance to an inherently imbalanced setting. Clan mechs, which are meant to be superior to Intersphere mechs in every way, right down to being better looking, are instead differentiated in a way that feels fair. Clan mechs generally boast more firepower and equipment, but suffer from overheating quickly, while Intersphere mechs are tougher, more flexible, and can stay in a fight longer. While we could talk for hours about the nuances of the game's balance, it overall ends up being somewhere within good. The matchmaker and tier system is hot garbage. Rather than separating players by skill level, it ends up separating players almost purely by hours played. While this does have an effect on the skill of players you're set up against, just due to the sheer hours played, quite a few bad players will make it into higher tiers eventually. While playing in Tier 1 and 2, most of the matches that I play end up as curb stomps, either from the enemy team having more skilled players, or from my team getting them. In either case, I leave the game feeling cheated of an exciting match. This is thankfully much less common in earlier tiers. As for how much playtime it takes to jump from one of the five ranks, appears to be about 100 hours each time. Both a strength and a weakness of the game is how heavily team-based it is. No one mech is able to win on its own, but each one can affect the battle enough to pull the tide in their team's favor. The gameplay is unique in that rather than being an unforgiving twitch-based shooter, a lot of it comes down to strategic positioning and outsmarting your opponents as much as being skilled at the controls. Weapons generate heat, and too much heat will either shut down or damage your mech, forcing you to know your mech's limits and play it accordingly. The core gameplay is solid. It's fun, and it's something you don't find in any other game out there. Mechs are not just segregated by weight classes. As you play the game, it becomes clear that mechs are distinguished more by how they are played than by how heavy they are. The Raven is a light, fast mech that some players will use as a light sniper that can quickly reposition, taking advantage of the enemy's every weakness, while another player will use it in close range to harass an enemy's flanks and pick off weaker mechs that have taken damage or strayed too far. Even more skilled pilots will use themselves as bait to draw enemies away and break apart their coordination. It's this type of strategic depth that keeps the game interesting. On the opposite end of the weight spectrum, an assault-class mech can be used to boast heavy amounts of firepower to focus down and suppress the enemy team, or they can be used to lead the charge with maximized armor, protecting the weaker mechs as the team advances. An assault mech can also specialize in brawling, in which they will single out an enemy target and focus it down in close range, pulverizing it into oblivion with short-range weaponry. The game allows any player to find their preferred tactical niche, or to endlessly explore new options with all the mechs that this game has to offer. While customizing your mechs is a long and difficult road, or an expensive one, it's very satisfying when you finally get there. Creating the perfect combination of weaponry and equipment on your favorite mech, then creating the perfect paint scheme for it with some decals as a finishing touch, is a great joy that you don't find in a game where classes or vehicles come with stock loadouts, or minimal customization options. The sheer number of mechs, and the differences in each and every single one, goes a long way. If you haven't been scared away, and you think that getting invested in Mechwarrior Online might be worth your time, there are a lot of great resources on the web that can help you improve at the game, as well as getting the most mileage out of your mech builds. Planning out good builds before buying into them is important after all. Smurfy's Mech Lab is a favorite of mine. It lets you build mechs, shows various statistics on their heat and damage efficiency, and points out the total cost for the mech, including all the parts and upgrades. There's a Mechwarrior subreddit called OutreachHPG, where you can discuss the game, get help with mech builds, or show off anything Mechwarrior Online related. There's an official subreddit for Mechwarrior Online as well that you can use. And of course, there's the official forums at mwomercs.com. If you're really into mech building, there's a website for simulating the heat generated by various mech builds. All links will be posted in the description. And that wraps up the review. In summary, the grind is awful for new players, and the game is stingy with its content. The customization is deep and exciting, but is hindered by the huge costs of doing so. The gameplay is unique, tactical, fun, and deep, but very rough around the edges. The game needs to work on its development flaws, and to make a strong effort to provide a rewarding experience. Then, Mechwarrior Online could end up as a good, even great game. As it stands, however, I just can't recommend it. Thanks for watching, no refunds, bye!